So today we are going to start our unit number 5, which is docks and harbors. Now a very, again, a different kind of concept or things that we are going to see in this unit, because till now we have seen a lot of mix of things, you can say, as far as the civil engineering is concerned. We saw the railway engineering, then different construction techniques, then tunnels, and then now we have started a totally different aspect of civil engineering, that is docks and harbors. And what we are mainly interested in this docks and harbors is the civil engineering perspective. Okay. So now from this photo, what you see at the background, this is a JNPT port in Navi Mumbai, Maharashtra. Okay. And what you see here is a typical harbor, you can say, or it's JNPT port basically. So there are three terms which go hand in hand and which you should be aware of before starting the discussion on this unit. So those three terms are docks, harbors and port. So one might think that, okay, all three are same or they are sort of synonyms to each other. Okay, you can say like that also. Many of the times, mainly the docks and harbors or the port and harbor, so they are sort of used as interchangeable thing or words for each other. But if you see technically, there is a fine difference between all three. So I'll first tell you that difference so that then we can start with the actual discussion of what is a dock and or what is a harbor and what goes into it. Okay. So the unit's name is docks and harbors, but the port is also there, an important part of it, which will be covering. So starting with the first thing, it's a harbor. So definition wise, if you see, so it's just a place on the coast, somewhere on the coast, there is a place where you can seek shelter. And you, as in your boats or ships or barges, whatever are there, so they can seek shelter in bad weather. So that is nothing but a harbor. Now this can be any place. So for the example, I have shown in this photo over here on the right side. So this is Koyilandy Harbor in Kerala. Okay. Now it's not a big of a harbor. As you see from the photograph, you'll see what is a big harbor or a big port, but just for giving an idea that what actually Hello, is my voice audible? There was a bit of power fluctuation for a second. Voice audible ahe ka ajun pan? Okay. So this photo I have shown you just to let you know the basic idea of a harbor. So it's not like it should be a very huge place or something like that. It can be any place on the coast, but the main purpose is it provides a shelter for your ships or a boat or a barge, anything. So ships and barges, they are a huge thing. What you see in this picture, all these are small boats, okay? Mainly fishery boats and some traveling boats. Okay? So any place on the coast which gives shelter can be known as a harbor. And then you have a variety of those harbors also. We'll look into it in detail in a few minutes. So that's harbor for you. Then you have port. Now port is something which you can say it is inside a harbor or it's a different entity altogether. It can be both ways. So if you have a very huge area on the coast which can be treated or which can be considered for as a shelter place for ships or boats, then within that huge area you can have a smaller area which is port. Or if you don't have a huge area but directly you have some area and you can treat that as a port also. So you say, I told you that both the terms port and harbor, they are sort of interchangeable terms as far as the use is concerned. So The reason is that you can have a port inside a harbor also, but you can have a port individually altogether without terming it as a harbor. So there is a very fine line, and that fine line goes like this, that port is also a place on coast, obviously, but what it does is it facilitates your loading and unloading of cargo. Okay, so this was not there in the definition of the harbor. In harbor, what we saw, it is just a place which gives you a shelter in bad weather. Okay. Now, why that bad weather is written is just a theoretical one, but it's not like you need to go to harbor only in bad weather. In general, wherever you have to park your ships or boats, okay, park is not the right term for it. We call it mooring, M-O-O-R-I-N-G. So we moor a ship or we moor a boat. So that is nothing but parking in common terms. Okay. So harbor is just a place where you can park, and port is a place where you can load and unload your cargo. So now all of you know that waterways is one of the important mode of transport, and mainly if we consider the intercontinental transfer, as in you have to send something from India to suppose say Africa. So you can also send it by plane, airways, no matter that. But if it's a heavy shipment, then we prefer it sending it by waterways. So a lot of cargo or containers you have, within which you can have different type of material. So that containers, the loading and unloading facility of that container or the cargo is possible at a port. So what photo you see on the right, again, it's a cover photo of our unit as well, or presentation. So it's a JNPT port, as I told you, Jawaharlal Nehru Port Trust port. So it's in Navi Mumbai, and what you see here, you can see in blue color a lot of crane-like structures over here. Okay. And then you have ships like this, huge ships, which carry containers. And basically what goes into that container is different kind of material. Okay. So the loading and unloading of these containers, it is done in the port. So I have written here that it is usually located inside a harbor. And I have written usually, I have not written compulsorily, but usually it is located inside a harbor, because considering that harbor is a huge area, so within that you can have a small area, not small as in compared to harbor, it's small area, okay, but again it's a huge one. So that's why I told you that it's usually, but not always. Sometimes you just have a port. You'll see the examples in a short time. So that's port. The difference what you can remember is harbor is just a place to seek shelter, and port is a place where you can load and unload your cargo. So maybe you can't do loading and unloading of cargo over here. What photo I have shown here, the harbor in Kerala, a small one. So here you can't have huge ships, and you don't see any facility of loading and unloading. It's just a place for seeking shelter for small boats, and that's fine. There are also harbors which are huge enough which can accommodate such ports. So JNPT, whenever it is said that JNPT, so it is termed as a port, it is not termed as a harbor. Though it is inside a harbor, within the Mumbai harbor, you will see. So though it's within the harbor, it's never termed as JNPT harbor. It's always termed as JNPT port, because that is specifically only for loading and unloading of cargo. So it's not like some fisherman has to seek shelter just before the storm. So that fisherman parks or moors his boat inside JNPT. It doesn't happen like that. Okay. So only the big ships which have to load and unload cargo, they are the ones who make a stop at JNPT port. And then the last one is dock. Now dock, again, it is a place within a harbor generally, and where your ships are loaded and unloaded. Now this is the common part with the port as well. In port also your ships were able to load and unload. But now the difference in dock is that here, along with loading and unloading, your ships can be built and repaired also. So the example you can see on the right side, I have shown, it's a photo of Kochi shipyard. Now dock, it is also known as sometimes dockyard. If you go by the terminology, so it is said as dockyard, or sometimes it is termed as shipyard as well. Okay. So dockyard, shipyard or dock, it's one and the same. So on the right side, what you see, it's a photo of a Kochi shipyard. Okay. Cochin or Kochi, you can say. So Kochi shipyard, and basically this photo I have mentioned because Kochi, it is the largest naval bases of India. And what you see here, this huge ship, so this is INS Vikrant, which is the first aircraft carrier which is built in India. So that is being built, and this photograph was taken somewhere around 2017. Okay. So yet this aircraft carrier is in construction phase, and it is expected to end in 2021 sometime. Okay. So this is nothing but a dock. So basically, you can load, unload ships at a dock also, but you also have a building and repairing facility. Okay. And that's almost the main purpose. Even if I have written loading and unloading first, but generally a dock is, generally it is used for building and repairing. But again, it's, you can say, not a harsh term over there. You can also use it for loading and unloading. So that's a dock for you. And now I hope you are in a position to differentiate between what's a harbor, what's a port, and what is a dock. Okay. So just to give a quick revision, harbor is any place along the coast where your ships or boats or barges or any floating vessel, it can take a shelter, maybe in bad weather or just as a resting place, you can say. Port is something where specifically you have loading and unloading of cargo, and it can be usually inside, located inside a harbor. And then dock, it is again a place within the harbor where you can have loading and unloading of ships along with the building and repairing works of the ship. So that's the difference between all three terms. And now we are hello, again there was a power fluctuation. आज काय खरं नाही एमएससीबी वाल्यांचं आमचं पण आवाज ऐकू येतोय का? इज द व्हॉइस स्टिल ऑडिबल? अगेन देर वॉज अ पॉवर फ्लक्च्युएशन. ओके ओके. सो दॅट्स द डिफरन्स बिटवीन द हार्बर, port and a dock. And now whatever is the discussion, we will carry on from here onwards. So now you'll clearly visualize or understand what is the difference between harbor, port and a dock. And at a few places you'll also see that mainly the port and harbor, these two terms, they are somewhat interchangeable at some locations. Okay. But keep in mind the basic definition and or basic purpose, instead of definition, the purpose for which all three are used. So now we'll see some classification related to harbors. Okay. Now, as we have termed that harbor, it is a huge place generally, or huge area. So we will see the classification of harbor first, and then we can go into the classification of other things, or the docks mainly. So in classification of harbor, the first classification is depending on the protection needed. Now, what is this protection needed is that, you all know, we are dealing with this docks and harbor, which is an interface between the sea or water and land, if I say it in a general way. And that water can be waters in sea, ocean, a small river, not small, a huge river or a canal. Okay, that can be any entity over there. And land is just a coast. It can be a coastal area, it can be a beach, or it can be some banks of a river. So depending on protection needed means, we are assuming that whatever are the waters or whatever is the water in this harbor area, that will be a calm water. Calm water as in the waves, what generally you see on beaches. Yeah. So if you could take a beach, you can't have, or a beach is not considered as a harbor, because on beaches you have the effect of waves. Okay, there are low tides and high tides, due to which there is variation in the water level, and also there is a lot of effect of waves over there. So we don't want that effect of waves in our harbor, because what we are saying is we are going to have different kind of work going on in your harbor. It is the loading of your cargo or unloading of your cargo, or even maybe building of a ship, a huge ship. Yeah. So though that building of a ship, it goes within a dock, but ultimately that dock is a part of a harbor. Or that loading and unloading, it goes on at a port, but that port, it may be a part of harbor. So you need some protection from that waves. So if we talk about how you need a harbor, or what should be the location of a harbor, so the main thing that you have to see while locating a harbor is there should not be a disturbance by the waves to the water level, which is there, or which you intend to maintain in the harbor or the port or the dock. Just because you have parked your ship, and consider that you are using that huge crane over here, okay, what you see here in the port, or even while building a ship, and you have huge cranes and you are building a huge ship, and due to waves there is movement to that ship. So obviously you can't work in such conditions. So that's why you need a protected area where your water is very calm and there is no effect of waves. So based on that, then you have a first classification, that is depending upon the protection needed. Okay. So in that, first you have a natural harbor, then a semi-natural, and then an artificial. Now I have given some examples, and we'll look into what is actually meant by a natural harbor. So the first example of this natural harbor is Mumbai. So Mumbai, you all know, or you might have heard, that Mumbai, it was never a huge piece of land. It was small islands, and then it was clubbed together, and then it was made as a piece of land. But if you see the location of Mumbai, so you have Mumbai over here. This is the main island of Mumbai, you can say. Then you have this Navi Mumbai, which is now developed. You have this Vashi Bridge over here. And then you have Panvel and that area somewhere over here. Okay. So this whole area, if you see, so in this side you have the Arabian Sea over here on the left side. And this is also Arabian Sea, or waters of the Arabian Sea, but whatever is the effect of that sea, or the waves, it will not be directly affecting this area. Okay. Whatever is this area that I am enclosing, so this area, it will not be affected directly by the waves. Okay. What will happen is the water level will fluctuate. Okay, that can be controlled, but what the lateral movement of the waves, they are not going to push your boats or whatever are the barges or the ships, if they are parked, or if they are utilizing this area, the area which I have just ticked mark. So this is nothing but a natural harbor. Okay, so this whole area, it can be considered as a natural harbor, because whatever is the main protection we are intending to give our harbor from the disturbance due to the waves and other calamities in the sea, so that are pacified or moderated in this area. Okay. And if you see here, you have the JNPT port over here, as I said. Okay. And if you consider the main Mumbai island, so this part of the Mumbai, so you have a lot of docks and harbors over here as well. So if you visit Mumbai sometime, so just think over it, or even if you are driving or traveling, just have a look that mainly whatever is the fishing business, or whatever is the ship related things which go on in Mumbai, so they are located on the eastern side of Mumbai and not the western one, because western one, it is directly exposed to Arabian Sea, and the eastern part, or the eastern coast you can say, of Mumbai, that is sort of away from the troubles of the sea. So this is nothing but the natural harbor. So Mumbai, it is known as the natural harbor because on all the side, almost on three sides, you have land, and then you have just one side through which your water can enter, and that can be controlled. Another example of natural harbor is Kandla. So Kandla, it is a place in Gujarat. So you, if you have seen the map of India, so Gujarat, it has somewhat like this kind of structure. Okay. So here you have Kandla, okay, in this area. I have just zoomed in the Gulf of Kutch. You have Kandla, and there again, now you see it is a Kandla port. It's not Kandla harbor, but it's Kandla port. So that's what I was talking about, that it's an interchangeable thing at lot of places, harbor and port, but the purpose or the name, it clearly defines the purpose. So Mumbai, it is said as a harbor because in Mumbai you have all kinds of things. You have shipping business going on, you have loading and unloading of cargo, you have construction of ships, you have naval bases in Mumbai, you also have fishing markets or fishing business in Mumbai. So everything goes on in that area. So it is termed as a harbor. But whereas Kandla, it handles only the cargo, and that's why it is termed as a port. But nevertheless, it's an example of, again, a natural harbor, because if you see, this is sort of a landlocked area on all three sides, and only the water can enter from this west or left side or western side, which is the Gulf of Kutch. Okay? And then you have calm water over here. So there, that's why the port is located at such a location, and it is not located at such a tip. Okay. So this is another example of a natural harbor. Then you have a semi-natural harbor, or you can also say, one can also say it's semi-artificial. So both are one of the same. Semi-natural or semi-artificial, what we have is, now you know that what is that protection that we need from the sea or the ocean or any water body. Okay. So mainly land and only one side by water. So in some cases, it's like you have two sides which you have land, and the third side you have to do something about it, so that you again sort of landlock it, yeah, or make a artificial land over there. So that is nothing but a semi-artificial or a semi-natural harbor. And Vishakhapatnam, again an example from India. So that is an example of semi-natural harbor. Now, why it is so? If you see the location of Vishakhapatnam, I have just zoomed in, but what you can do is you can search it on your Google map also. So this is the one side, which is the natural land you have on this side. Okay. Then this is the another side where you have natural land. Okay. But now what we saw is generally a three-sided land is good for locating a harbor. So now here you have two sides, but you need to have the third side also. So you see some kind of a structure over here. It's known as a breakwater. What is a breakwater? We will be seeing in detail in next few lectures, but for now just remember that this is something called breakwater. Okay. So now what is done at Vishakhapatnam is, they were having land on two sides, and they wanted to construct use this Vishakhapatnam as a harbor. So what they did is, they constructed breakwaters, two breakwaters at Vishakhapatnam. Okay. So due to that, what has happened now, you see, there is sort of land on all three sides and there is just one opening for the water. And now we have, what we have done is whatever is the forces or the waves or the movement of the Bay of Bengal on the right side. So that is restricted and we are only allowing this much passage for the water. So whatever is the harsh movements or harsh conditions in the Bay of Bengal, that will not directly affect the Visakhapatnam harbor, but the water level will just fluctuate, but that is also a controlled one. So this is nothing but a semi-artificial or a semi-natural harbor. Okay. Now again, Visakhapatnam, if you search, so it is again one of the important navy bases, naval bases of India. Okay. And along with that, you have other things also going on at Visakhapatnam. You have a cargo terminal where you have a, can see here, Visakha container terminal. So it is a terminal or it is a port where you have the loading unloading of cargo. You have also a shipping harbor where specifically only shipping or fishing is done, sorry, not shipping, fishing harbor. So that's a semi natural harbor. And then you have a artificial harbor. Now again, what you have to keep in mind is we need land on three sides at least, and then you can have water from one side. Now Chennai, if you again search on Google Map, so Chennai, it is the southmost or southeast most part of India, where if you see the coastline, it is almost straight. Okay. So what you see here in this Google image also, so this is the actual natural land, what you say, or what I've just highlighted with the red line. Okay, so that's the natural land of Chennai. But again, they wanted to develop a harbor over here. So obviously, you can't have a harbor where you have land only on one side. Okay, so now what they did is, again, they constructed breakwaters over here. And if you see, what they did is just a single piece of land what they had, so they closed it from the sea is also calm over there. Sometimes it so happens that due to the vast geographical area, now if you consider India, so India, if I just draw the outline of the coastal part of India, so maybe it might look something. So if you see India, it has a huge coastline. And that was also the reason that in ancient days India was the trade center, because ancient days when there was no airways developed, all the transport or all the exchange of goods, goods and even the people, that was done by ships. And then India being a peninsular country and having a large coastline, it was a prime location, you can say. Okay. So now obviously, if you have such a vast coastline, you have to protect it also. Okay. So protect it and also use it for trading purpose. So you need to develop different locations. So maybe in this area where you have Kandla Port or where you have Mumbai, so there you have natural land available in such a way that you don't have to construct a specific or your huge breakwater. But there are some locations like suppose Chennai. So Chennai, as I told you, it is the southeast most part of India. So here somewhere you have Chennai. And the next port above Chennai is Visakhapatnam, and then you have Paradip. So just to complete the chain, that you should have ports at or harbors at almost regular intervals, so that you can manage all the cargo and all the movement, and also protect your country from the external forces. So for that, you need to construct some harbor wherein you don't have the geographical help, that you don't have land on all sides, but you have to construct a harbor over there, then you can go for an artificial harbor. So that's why that artificial harbor concept has come into picture. Okay. So this is the classification based on the protection needed. Next is the classification of harbor based on the utility. Okay. Now we will be talking about that, why you are using this harbor, or for what purpose you are using this harbor. So that is, we are talking about the utility of that harbor. So first classification is just a basic one, you can say. Okay, that harbors of refuge as in, if there is some bad weather in the ocean or in the sea, and generally you get a warning for that, but if suddenly there is a bad weather, then you have to take some refuge. Or if there is a sudden outbreak of a war, so for that your ships or boats, whatever are there, you'll need a refuge area. So if that is the purpose of your harbor, then it is known as a harbor for refuge. And generally you don't see, or in India at least, we don't have any harbor which is specifically built only for refuge. Okay. Generally harbors, you have to, it is a system that you develop, so you have to generate a revenue out of it, and then you have to keep it sustainable. So for that, no harbor in India, at least of my knowledge, is there only for refuge purpose. So it is a combination that you have some business activity going on, or a commercial part of it, or use for fishery or any kind of thing. Okay. So that's the harbor for refuge. Second is the commercial harbor. Now commercial harbor, from the term itself, you will understand that commercial as in whatever the concept of port we had seen, that port was used for loading and unloading of cargo. So this commercial harbor is specifically for that purpose. And the example for it, now I have moved out of India. So I have taken an example of Shanghai in China. Now again, if you search Shanghai harbor, you will not get Shanghai harbor, but it is known as Shanghai port. So on the left side, what you see, the Google image of Shanghai. So here somewhere you have that Shanghai port, and on the right side is one part of that port. It's not actually complete port that you see on this in this photograph, but it's just one part of Shanghai port. Okay. So it is the largest port in the world in the terms of handling cargo. Okay. So yearly it handles lakhs of tons of cargoes. Okay, so this is nothing but a commercial harbor. Specifically, it is only used for commercial purposes, loading and unloading of cargo. That's it. There is no building facility, or no might be there will be a repair facility over there, obviously, but majority work is the commercial work. Okay, so that's why it's termed as a commercial harbor. Okay. And again, as I told you, harbor and port, it can be interchangeable. So Shanghai, it is an example of commercial harbor, but it is known as Shanghai port and not a Shanghai harbor. The reason for it is that only loading and unloading takes place over there. So it's sort of a JNPT port what we have in India, in Maharashtra. So sort of that it is there in Shanghai. So that's the example of commercial harbor. The next type or classification that you have based on the utility is fishing harbor. Again, I have taken example of Chennai itself. So this photograph, what you had seen of Chennai over here, Chennai harbor. So one part of that Chennai harbor is used for just fishing purpose. Okay, and that is basically termed as a fishing harbor. So here, if you see, you can see very small boats, they are gathered over there. Okay. So that is only with the purpose of developing the fish industry, that whatever are the boats or some medium ships which catch fishes. So only those are loaded and unloaded over here. So that's a fishing harbor. Okay. So utility wise, this is the example of it. Then you have next example or next classification based on the utility, that is a military harbor. And the example for it is Vishakhapatnam. As I told you, it is one of the naval bases. So this is what a military harbor looks like. So what you see over here, these are submarines, Indian submarines. Okay, also a naval ship over here. So here only the ships or boats which are of Indian Navy, they are allowed, obviously, because it is a military harbor. Okay. So that's the type or classification of military harbor. And then the last classification or last type in the classification based on utility is a marina harbor. Now, marina harbor is somewhat, you can say that the people who have their private ships or boats or yachts. Okay. So those need also a place to park somewhere. So that is, or that parking place or that mooring place is provided by marina harbor. Okay. It's just another term. The main purpose is whatever are the small individual boats or boats only, you can say. Nobody has a ship as such personally or individually. Individually, if you have to purchase, you either purchase a boat or a yacht, you can say. So for that, whatever is the area which is provided, that is nothing but a marina harbor. So examples I have given on the top, what photo you see on the right, top right. So that photo from Croatia, there's a place called Kornati. So there you have this marina harbor. Now you can see just they are parked. It's no, nothing business is being done that there is no fishing business or there is no unloading, loading of cargo, nothing like that. Just private boats which are parked over there. Okay. Another photo on the bottom, what you see is photo from a country called Malta in Europe. So this is again an example of a marina harbor. Okay. So that's all with the classification of harbors based on the utility. So you had this five classification. We had seen, we saw examples for each except the first one. So first one is in general harbors for refuge, but I told you there is no such harbor, at least in India, which is constructed only for refuge purpose, that whenever there will be bad weather, you will use that harbor as a refuge one, and other days it will not be used. So it's not like that. Then you have a commercial harbor, example I gave Shanghai. Fishery harbor, example Chennai. Military harbor, you have military harbors at Mumbai, Cochin, and many other places in India, but these two are the major one. And the example I showed you was for Vishakhapatnam, the photograph. Then marina harbor we saw for Croatia and Europe. So this is classification of harbor based on the utility. And the last classification is the one which is based upon what is the water body we are dealing with. So as I told you, a harbor is nothing but sort of an interface between your land and water. And that water part, it can be anything. It can be a gulf, it can be a strait, it can be a bay, sea, ocean, whatever the types of water forms you have studied in your school. So it can be any of that. So depending on that, you have a canal harbor, a lake harbor, a river harbor, or a ocean or a sea harbor. Okay. So now in India, what we have predominantly is this sea and ocean harbor, because you know that the inland waterways of India, it is not that much developed. The rivers or the canals, they are not really used for transport of ships or goods. Okay. So in India, whatever harbors you will find, those are just sea or ocean harbors. Okay. Mainly sea harbors only, or somewhat on the Indian Ocean side, you have a ocean harbor. But in other countries, in the Western countries predominantly, they use the canals and rivers for transporting their goods and people also. So there you can have a canal harbor or a river harbor. Lake harbor, very rarely you can find. maybe the lakes which are very huge in size. So one such example you can take is the lake in Africa. I guess it's Lake Victoria, which is surrounded by Tanzania, Uganda, and some other countries. So it's the largest lake in the world, I guess, one of the largest, I think. So there you can have such lake harbors also. So I have not included any photographs for this because it's just based on the water body and you know what is a lake, a river, a canal, and a sea. So that's all with the classification of harbor. And just to finish today's session, so there is something called selection of site for harbor. Now this is general things that you have to take care while selecting a harbor. So if I tell you that you have to go and search for a location somewhere in Maharashtra other than Mumbai where you can develop a harbor, so what all things you will look into is the availability of obviously the material and land. So as harbor you will require a huge land, and if it's readily available at lower rates or if it's a government property, then it's very good for us. Then the transport and communication facility, obviously, because you can't construct a harbor which is away from everything. It is disconnected, it doesn't have proper telecommunication system, it doesn't have proper roads or not even a railway track. So that kind of location also it is not suitable, because if you are going to develop it for some loading unloading of cargo, so obviously that cargo should reach the harbor, and whatever is the cargo reaching the harbor, it has to be taken back to the land as well. So the transport and communication facilities are important. Then the natural protection from winds and waves. Now this we have seen that why you require a natural protection. Then industrial development, if it is there in the locality, and the subsoil condition, that is the seabed, how it is. So you can take help of the terms that we have discussed in dredging, the construction technique. So that there also we had discussed that what is the type of bed, depending on that you will adopt some of the dredging techniques. So same way for constructing a harbor also, you need to first study that seabed also. And obviously you are going to construct something over there, so there is always going to be a damage to the ecology, but you have to see to it that there is a bare minimum damage. Then the traffic potentiality of harbor, this is something to do with when you construct a harbor, so it has to be utilized. It's not like you have constructed it and then there is no ship coming to your harbor, or maybe one or two ships coming in a year. Okay, so that will not serve the purpose of that harbor. So you need to have the traffic potential in it. Then available to utilities such as electric supply and the fresh water. Then defense and strategic aspects. So this is if you are considering or searching for an area to develop as another naval command for India. So there you have to think about the defense and strategic aspect, that what is the location and how well it is covered. And then some other maps or surveys you can do, or you need to do is topographical study, the contour study. Then there is something called tide survey or tidal stream map. Now this is to do with, we are seeing that we don't want a lot of fluctuations in your water level inside your harbor. So for that, all these three studies are required: tide survey, tidal stream map, and wave height survey. Okay. And just something related to it, which is not in your syllabus, but I thought that it will be a beneficial thing to know, that you all know what is a tide. Okay. The high tides and low tides that are there in the sea or the ocean near the land. So why does that happen is, you all know that because of the gravitational force of the moon or the sun, due to that there is a rise of water, and that is known as a tide. So there are types in that tide also. So you have a spring tide in which the sun and moon, they are on the same side of earth. So here you can see on the right side, this is the sun, direction of the sun, and at the same side you have moon. And due to that, whatever are the tides you will have, those are the spring tides. Then you have, sorry for the overlapping, there has been a overlapping of text. So just a minute, if I can it. So there is something called neap tide also. Neap tide, in that what happens is the sun and the moon, they are at 90 degrees. So you can see on the right side you have sun and the moon is on the exactly perpendicular to it. So that is nothing but a neap tide. And if you see the water level, this blue colored line that you have around Earth, so that will show you that what can be the tentative levels of water. So in spring tide, if you see the height or the level is somewhat high than the neap tide. I guess everywhere that just a minute. So that's the neap tide. Then again you have a spring tide, but now here the position of the sun and moon, it's exactly opposite. So one spring tide we saw in which the sun and moon, they were on the same side of Earth. So that time you had a spring tide, but now you have a spring tide when the sun is on one side and the moon is on other side. Okay? So in that case also the water levels, they are a bit high. And then you have again a neap tide, but now again the sun and the moon, they are perpendicular to each other, but now the angle you can see it's 270. So before, in the previous neap tide, the moon was here, now the moon is on the lower side. So why you need to study these tides, that is the neap tide and spring tide? Because there is something, they affect the levels of water. So what we know is only the high tide or low tide, but if you go in details, that high tide and low tide also, it can be differentiated based on the position of your moon and sun. So if you mark just the levels of water, suppose for high water spring tide, this is the level, then high water neap tide. So in neap tide also there is a high and low. Similarly in spring tide also there is a high and low. So if you mark all the levels, so this is all the levels that we'll get. And now if you find out the average and all, then you will be in a position to understand that, okay, this is the location and what is the fluctuation of water level over here. Then you will come to know that, okay, is it suitable to be constructed, or is this site suitable for a harbor or only a port or only a dock. So that's why you need to study this tides. Now, though it's not in the syllabus, I thought it will be useful for you just to understand that what is a tide. You all know what is a tide, but what are the types and how it is connected. So it is used in our civil engineering for the purpose of finding out these levels of water. Okay. So for which situation, what will be the level of water, and accordingly then we'll decide. Maybe it will also happen that you have selected this location somewhere in Maharashtra along the coast where you have all the parameters, all these parameters which are satisfied, but only maybe the water level is not that much sufficient, or there is low water level considering all the average or all the types, and then you need to increase that water level. So maybe you will select that site, but for adjusting the water level or for increasing the water level, you will use the dredging technique which we have studied in the unit number 3. Okay, so using that dredging, you will remove some of the part of the seabed, and in that way you can increase the depth of your water level out there. Okay. So that's all for today. We'll stop here.